now I'd like to introduce Mathew Forstater from UMKC and Research Director at the Binzagr Institute, who will chair the first session. Matt.
Okay, actually, I think I would ask all the panel members to come down, but if any are using PowerPoint, then maybe actually your fellow panel members, so maybe one at a time, and then after everyone's done for discussion, we'll have everyone come. Does that sound? And are we... Okay, so, yeah, great. All right, well, good afternoon, everyone. I also am very happy to be here. I don't need to thank everybody again because many thanks have been given. So I think it's time that we proceed with more of the substantive discussion. This panel, session one, is called Towards Sustainable Communities. And we have three papers on the panel. Ahmed Soliman, who is from here at Denison, on sustainable energy for developing countries. Elsadig.
For developing communities. It's more of a general talk to show you what's out there in terms of affordable, sustainable systems that can be actually used in rural areas and rural communities and developed communities. And I really, just first of all, I need to say that I'm really happy to see a title like this, Institute for Sustainable Prosperity. I rarely see anything that relates sustainable and prosperity in one sentence. I don't really find this a lot. And also the other thing is, this picture here basically summarizes what I'll be talking about, so I might as well just finish it in 10 minutes. So here, basically, it shows solar ovens. Instead of using biomass, and I'll be talking about this, we can use actually the sun to cook our food and so on. And I'll be talking about this in more details in a second. So the topics that I'll be discussing, it's a little bit high for me. So energy and the path to prosperity and the relation between them. The global primary consumption and production of energy. Basic energy needs in developing and rural communities, and I'll be using switching between developing and rural a lot. So, in the world in terms of energy servants. So on the x-axis here, you see the region, and the y-axis, you see the number of energy servants per person or per capita. And as you can see here, the average in the world is about 27 energy servants. So this means the average, on average, 27 people are working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in order to provide us with energy that we need every day. Now, I'm not talking about just energy that you have in your home, but here we're talking about total amount of energy. So energy to plant the trees, plant the crops, and harvest them, freeze them, heat them, and driving your car, taking the plane, coming here, turning on these lights, so any kind of energy that you're using throughout the day. So in the US, or should I say, like in North America in general, US, Canada, and Mexico, we're using about 86 energy servants. So that makes it a little bit easier to comprehend how much energy we're actually using. In Africa, on the other hand, if we're to look at Africa, on average, it's about 5 energy servants. So you can see the big difference between the consumption between Africa as a developing continent in this case and North America. Now, if we were to look at the Human Development Index, and I use this as a sign for prosperity, and I think this is acceptable in the economics world, right? The Human Development Index. So the higher the index, the better. The lower the index, that's not so good, because it includes the life expectancy, it includes the education level, that basically the prosperity in life in general. And as you can see here, this is plotted as a function of the energy servants that you're using. So the more energy servants, as you can see here, the better the life that you'll get, the higher the human development index. However, you notice that around 50 energy servants, it kind of like starts plateau or go a little bit lower. To me, this is actually good news. And the reason for that is you can actually create a cutoff for where is the proper line for, or on average, where's the proper line for energy consumption that you can have and still be able to have good life. And I guess Switzerland will be a good example for a prosperous country, right? So what we're trying to do here is try to bring these guys from using too much energy and still maintaining the same kind of life expectancy and the same kind of prosperity, bring them all the way to here in terms of energy conservation. And at the same time, we're trying to bring these guys up from being low in the energy consumption and low in the human development index all the way up to where it's an appropriate level as compared to Switzerland, for example. So this is what we are trying to do, conserve and also bring up the other countries. So, yes. What do you mean by carrying capacity?
What is the maximum energy used that isn't extracted from the earth? So there's a different version of this chart that takes the Human Development Index.
Right.
It's coming in terms of environmental energy, environmental capacity. And so there's a similar chart, just the dotted line is more to the left, because it's hard to get human development with any energy that won't be extracted from the earth.
Oh, I see. So you're not using fossil fuel and so on. That's
the more renewable, the more
right. So you're all right. So I guess if I understand your question, like using energy flows rather than fuel. So instead of using something that will disappear after a while, use something that's renewable, right? More or less. Yeah. No. Unfortunately, I don't have a graph like that, but I'm sure we can do this estimate. But I haven't. Yeah, that would be interesting to see. So where do you use this energy? Basically, this energy can be basically this. Used in four sectors. And these four sectors, or four main sectors, are basically residential, commercial, industrial sector, and transportation. Now, this is the average of the world. Of course, for every individual country, the sectors will look different. So for instance, if you were to look at China, the industrial sector actually goes almost like 75%. And if we were to look at developing countries, if you take Ghana, for example, then the residential, instead of having a 13%, it goes almost to 60%. There's not too much industry over there. So this keeps on fluctuating based on the sector we're talking about. So the energy systems that I'll be covering today will roughly cover these four sectors, and I'll show you examples for that. So whenever we talk about energy, if you don't mind, I'm gonna stand over here to see it. So whenever we talk about energy, we need to couple this with a couple of things. First, the population, second, the population growth rate, right? Things are not static on Earth. So for instance here, if you look at the energy per capita, or the energy consumption per capita, Africa over here is the lowest, followed by Asia, and then of course North America here is using too much energy per capita. However, if you were to couple this with the population, the total consumption of energy will look different, and your total impact on the environment would look a little bit different as well. So it's not gonna be as low as here. So combining this with the population growth rates, China is going very high, 44 millions or 44 and a half millions per year. If you were to compare that with Europe, for example, it's 2.5 million per year. So there's a big difference in the population growth. So if we're trying to develop or make lives better in developing and rural areas, we need to take into consideration the impact on the environment, the total impact on the environment. Just because Asia right now is not using a lot of energy per capita, however, just adding to it the population growth and also the population, then the total consumption will look a little bit different, as you can see here. So the total consumption of energy, this graph basically shows the consumption of energy and the production of energy in every region here. Total consumption of energy, even though Asia is using per capita less energy than North America, however, the total consumption of energy because of the population is adding to the mix. So you can see the total consumption here is higher. And also from this graph, you can see who's actually producing and who's using more energy than what they need. North America producing less than what they consume, Asia producing less than what they consume. The Middle East is definitely producing more, and this is where you see the trade between the different countries in terms of energy. So what are the basic needs for any developing nation or for any rural community? It's basically two things, heat and electricity. I'm gonna be taking Africa as an example here. So if we were to look at the traditional biomass use for heating in Africa, as you can see here, on average you have about 70% of the population in Africa rely on traditional biomass for heating or for cooking mainly. North Africa, not so much, so it's not really a big problem for them, for now at least. And I'm gonna show you an example where actually biomass is a big problem for North Africa, Egypt for example. But anyway, for now, we're gonna say that population does not rely that much on biomass. The issue with biomass is it's used for cooking or for heating, and it's used unprocessed. So this is a very inefficient way of actually producing heat, and that has a very negative impact on the environment and on health. So if you wanna look at the total population in millions, so here, total population that relies on traditional biomass for use, sub-Saharan Africa, you're talking about 700 million people rely on biomass. If you look at the percentage of electrification in Africa, North Africa is doing very well. So they already have central grids that extend almost everywhere. Rural areas don't have major issues with electricity. However, the grid is not totally reliable though. So even though it's extended, that doesn't mean it's reliable. However, if you look at sub-Saharan Africa, only about 16% or 17% of the population actually receives electricity from the grid. To me, this is good news. This means we can actually go with different types of sustainable energy that we can use in rural areas away from using central grids and be able to electrify or provide electricity to rural areas. So if you look at the total population without electricity, in sub-Saharan Africa, about 600 million people, as compared to North Africa, it's only 1 million. So how do we meet the needs? How do we meet the needs for heating, and how do we meet the needs for electricity? There are two ways. Either we go the traditional route, or we go the sustainable route. So I'm gonna go over what will happen if we go the traditional route, and I'm gonna go over what we can have if we have the sustainable route. And I'll try to do this in 30 minutes. Thank you. People who do not have electricity from the grid. So that will be, like for instance in Egypt, for example, it will be like almost 80 million or 80 something million. Yeah, I don't have the total population, but it's one minus the other.
Well,
yeah.
You've got the 60 percentage, so it's 99%
Well, yeah, I guess if you, so I guess if you go this route, so you have the 622 million, and you multiply that by the 26%, you can figure out the total population of Africa. And then from that, you subtract the one for Sub-Sahara, and then you have what's left for North America, North Africa. So if you go the traditional route, this means you have centralized grids. And this means you're going to be using fossil fuels. So if you have a centralized grid with major power plants, then you simply just extend the grid. And then, of course, you're going to be using fossil fuel in this case. The sustainable route, on the other hand, is, instead of using centralized grids, you can use what's called micro or mini grids. Or better yet, you can use what's called the standalone systems. And I'm gonna be covering this in a second here. And of course, you can use bioenergy. So if you're going to be relying on biomass, or if the population relies on biomass, you might as well just make them rely on biomass, but in a more efficient way. So this way, they're not producing too much pollution, and they're not harming themselves a lot. So if we were to look at the centralized grids, the cost of extending the grid based on the World Bank estimates in 2000 is about $10,000 $10,000 per kilometer. However, in my opinion, this is a very conservative estimate. The DOE here in the US estimates it three times that. It's about $31,000 per kilometer if you want to be extending the grid. And of course, it's going to depend on the terrain. It's going to depend on the power you're trying to deliver, the number of substations you're going to have on the way, and also it's going to depend on the labor cost. If it's in the US, it's going to be more. If it's in Africa, it's going to probably be less. So all of this are different factors that will go into estimating how much money you're going to be spending to extend the grids to rural areas. Nevertheless, the point I want to get across here is it's expensive. You cannot just simply extend the wire and that's it. The other issue is, even if you extend the grid, the quality of the centralized grid itself might not be that good. So you might have vulnerability in the grid, the power can go down, and you might have issues. And this, we see this a lot in developing countries. And even if you have a centralized grid connected to your home, you might as well just have, because it's vulnerable and it's not available all the time, you need to have some sort of a secondary power supply, for instance, like a generator or a solar cell or a wind turbine and so on. And worst of all, if you're going to be using the centralized systems, most likely you're going to be relying on fossil fuel, either natural gas or oil or coal to be able to supply this. So what are the effects of fossil fuel? You can divide them into two categories. One is local and short-term, and the other one is long-term and global. So if you were to look at the short-term, for example, this is a picture from China in 2014. The air quality was so bad. This is taken in the morning, by the way. So the air quality was so bad that they had to actually broadcast sunrise and sunset on screens and major squares. If you care about artwork, this is the impact of acid rain on artwork. So this picture was taken in 1908. The same picture is taken again in 1968, 60 years difference, and you can see the impact of acid rain. If you don't care that much about art, you need to care about the integrity of the building. So you can see here the corrosion or the disappearance of the mortar that's holding the bricks together. So you have issues there. If you don't care about the bricks and you don't care about the artwork, you should care about the ecology. Acid rain, when it falls on the ground, increases the acidity on the ground, decreases the acidity in the lakes and fresh water. So that causes big problems to fish, causes big problems to birds, and so on. So the ecosystem will start changing. Air pollution in urban areas, especially if it has a lot of particulates, is bad. This picture is from Sydney, so this is an area. So this is a lung of a person who used to live in an area, and I believe it was Sydney, as compared to the lung of a person, and these are two are non-smokers, as compared to a lung of a person who lived in rural community. So you can see the big difference based on the air quality. So I'm going to be focusing on particulate matter, or the PMs. And I'll give you an example right now for why. Just a clear to make sure we understand what PM is. So PM is particulate matter. They can be formed directly at the source, or they can form chemically in the atmosphere. They have different sizes. If you want to compare this to your human hair is about 70 microns in size. PM10 is about 7 times smaller than the human hair. PM2.5, which is smaller, 2.5 microns and smaller, is actually much smaller than, like, four of them will fit in the PM10 and so on. And as compared to a sand particle, fine sand particle, you can see the difference between PM2.5 and a regular sand particle. Why do we talk about this? Well, lungs, like what you saw in the other picture that you had before. Anything higher than PM10 can be stopped by your nose, basically, and your throat. So it's going to be captured by your nose and throat. However, anything less than PM10, like PM2.5, PM1, PM0.1, and so on, it will start traveling through your throat into your lungs. And the problem is, the smaller they get, the harder for your lungs to cough them out. So they stay there. And right now, some new research actually found that ultra-fine particles, like in the nano-sized particles, actually go into the bloodstream. So they can get launched into the brain, they can get launched into the kidneys, into the liver, and so on, and some might cause cancer. The issue is not with the particles themselves or the particulates themselves, but actually, because they have a large surface area with respect to their volume, they can absorb a lot of chemicals on their surface. So now you're not only transporting the particles, but you're transporting the particles plus the chemicals that are absorbed on the surface of the outside. So that becomes a big problem. If you want to look at the impact, health impacts, premature death, non-fatal heart attacks, aggravated asthma, decreased in lung function, and so on. So it's really bad. Particulate matter is really bad. Now let's look at the picture of particulate matter, PM2.5, globally. You can see here most of North Africa, the Middle East, all the way basically the Central and Southeast Asia. They are the highest pollutants here. You have some in Central America, a little bit in Southern South America. So population-wise, you have a lot of population that's being exposed to high values of PM2.5. And actually, here we're talking about, like say if you wanna look at Egypt, for example, so we're talking about something in the range of the 50 micrograms per cubic meter. In the US, the cutoff value for specified by the EPA, of course, that for healthy living in the presence of PM2.5 is 35. So we're going way above that over there in Egypt. So we need to do something about this. The nice thing about short-term localized effects is once you fix them, it's not going to take that long of a time to actually see the difference. And it can affect the environment locally much quicker than if we were to talk about global warming and so on. This is what we're familiar with, more familiar with. So when you talk about long-term impact of fossil fuel, you basically think, the first thing you think of is the polar bears and the melting of the ice, of the glaciers and the ice cap and so on. You think of the dry or the drought and flooding cycle, the change in the drought and flooding cycle and so on. Global effects take a long time to fix and they take a long time to observe. So if you were to look at the total emissions of CO2 and one of the, of course, one of the greenhouse gases that we all know is CO2. So if you look at the emissions of CO2, Asia has taken the biggest part in the emissions, followed by North America. And Africa is not really that far behind Eurasia and South America. And actually, if you were to take into the consideration the growth, the population growth and so on, there might be a chance where you actually see these we maintain things as inefficient as they are right now, we might see these things or the emissions actually growing higher. Now, this is a very impressive map. Here we're looking at black carbon. Black carbon are particulates that are black. They are actually more of a greenhouse. It's not a gas, it's a particulate. More of a greenhouse element than CO2. 1 kilogram of black carbon lasting for 2 weeks in the atmosphere is equivalent to 700 kilograms of CO2 lasting for 100 years in terms of the impact on the environment, in terms of the global warming. So look at this. This is the black carbon coming out and the impact of black carbon on warming the earth, coming out from something as simple as residential kerosene lamps. So as you can see here, the developing countries basically take the most of the highest emitters, basically, in terms of black carbon coming from something as simple as a small kerosene lamp. So the common sources of air pollution are basically, like what you see here, a small kerosene lamp that is being widely used in Africa and in developing countries in general. They're being used for night use, of course, and sometimes even for day use. And even when the sun is out and it gets too dark inside, there are no windows and so on, so you might actually use that. The other source for air pollution is cooking, using biomass in enclosed environment, like indoors like this. And another example, like in North Africa, like in Egypt, burning the agriculture waste. And this is a major problem that happens in Egypt every fall. Farmers basically dry up all the waste that they have from the harvesting season, and they let it dry, and then after that they burn it. And when they burn it, all of this clad will cover the delta and cover Cairo and becomes a major problem. This happens every fall. So what we're trying to do here is trying to harvest this and make it in a more sustainable way rather than, and make a good use of it rather than just waste it like that. The World Health Organization and UNDP released a statement back in 2004, considered working in the kitchen as a dangerous thing to do. Like, it's completely different than what we have here in the US, for example. If you want to have fun with your family, you just go to the kitchen, make a nice meal. However, it's completely different if you were to talk about rural areas. Making a meal is basically a lethal thing to do. If you were to look at what's called the energy ladder, the more you go in terms of economic prosperity and development, the better the type of fuel that you can use for cooking, for example. This example over here shows an open wood, an open flame wood stove. And as you can see, it's indoors. One of the major issues, of course, is wood is being burned inefficiently. You're gonna have a buildup of CO2 and particulates inside the room. And also, since it's a combustion process, it's actually using oxygen in the room. So after a while, you have a decrease in the concentration of oxygen, you have an increase in CO2, and then you have an increase in particulate matter. And all of this while you have women and children are in home. Some of the articles that I've seen actually talk about indoor pollution as gender-specific and age-specific. And the reason for that is most of the people are exposed to it are basically women and children. And that basically goes into the health impacts and how premature deaths for children can actually be impacted by something as simple as cooking at home. So this is if we were to go the traditional route. Now let's look at the happy side here. If you were to go with a sustainable route, look at solar energy. You can use solar thermal for heating, and this can be done for residential and commercial systems. And here I'm talking small scale. I'm not talking large scales like what we have here in the US in terms of solar thermal power plants and so on. So everything I'll be talking about is small scale, residential, village scale type, and so on. So solar thermal for heat, solar PV for electricity, and can be used residential and commercial as well. The bio-waste, instead of just burning it inefficiently, we can actually process this bio-waste and make good use of it in a more efficient way. So you can have powder combustion to produce heat in a larger scale than residential. So you can use it in commercial and industrial. You can use gasification to produce gases that you can use to run your engine, for example. So it can be used for transportation, commercial and industrial. And then biogas that can be used for heat for residential and commercial systems. Biogas is basically collecting all the human waste and animal waste and so on and trap it in a big container underground so it does not get exposed to air. So you're gonna have anaerobic digestion that's happening inside the biomass, and then it's gonna release methane. And then you capture this methane and you can use it for cooking, to burn it for cooking and so on, or for heating and so on. I'll be talking more in details about gasification and powder combustion because this is where what I did in my research. Solar, as you can see here, in terms of radiation, the developing countries are actually blessed by having too much solar incident on their land. So if you can see here, the highest radiation incident per meter squared per day globally is actually located in the zone where we have developing countries, right, where we have rural areas and so on. So we can use solar for solar applications for rural areas. So how do you use solar PV? You can use it for in a mini-grid system. Basically, you and your neighbors decide to install solar panels and you connect all yourselves together away from the centralized grid, and then basically you form your own tiny little microgrid or tiny little mini-grid, and this is what you use for power supply. You don't have major infrastructure. It's a localized system, so it's near consumption points. So you don't have a lot of transmission cables to transfer all the power. This means you're not gonna have higher voltages, which actually would reduce the cost. and can be set up by individuals or co-ops. So it's either I can set it up in my home, or I can just form a co-op between myself and my neighbors and then form this energy system. And of course, in a standalone system, you have your solar system, and then it's connected to batteries for charging, and then you can use that for powering your home and powering the other appliances that you have. Now, if we were to look at the solar electric generation and around the world, it's unfortunate that even though Africa and the Middle East and Central and South America are actually exposed to too much radiation of the sun, actually good radiation of the sun, there's nothing called too much radiation, it's always good to have sun. Even though they are exposed to a lot of sun, however, in terms of the solar electricity generation, they are really not even close to where they should be. Europe, on the other hand, that actually gets less radiation, are actually doing way better than North America and doing definitely way better than Africa and the Middle East and so on. So that needs to change. So there's a bright side to that. Even though Africa is low, however, there are major leaps here that you can see from 2000 to 2012 in terms of generation. Even though it's still a small scale and small amount, however, at least consciously they are starting to understand this and they're starting to adopt solar systems in their electric generation. And one thing that will add to that is basically the price of power that you get from solar arrays is actually dropping right now. So we started in the 70s by almost $80 per watt. Right now we're going to close to 80 cents per watt. So that's a major drop down in terms of cost. What can you use solar power for? You can use it to power small water pumps to get clean water. You can generate electricity for it for small consumption, like in small huts like this. You can use it instead of kerosene lamps. You can have solar LED lamps to light up the house and so on in a nicer and a cleaner manner. And also, this is not a solar-powered camel. This is actually a solar-powered clinic. It's a mobile clinic that goes from town to town. And the way to keep the medicine cold is by having refrigerators. How would they power this? Using solar panels here. And the nice thing is they use the camels to transport the medicine rather than using SUVs because they are cheaper, that's one thing, and they can handle the desert much better than an SUV. So this picture is taken from Kenya, I believe. So that's always a good thing to see. What about the solar thermal applications? They're straightforward, like what you see here. So you can have solar stoves, you can have solar ovens, and you can have solar thermal systems for heating water that you can use for cooking or for bathing and so on for whatever application you're gonna be using. Now, the eco-village concept, and this is something that I'm actually working on right now. How do you introduce the eco-village concept to rural areas? So, since we're trying to develop the country, or the community rather, let's develop it in a more eco-friendly way. So, what do we mean by eco-friendly? We talk about low-cost construction using local materials, so instead of relying on cement and relying on concrete and steel and so on, we can actually rely on local material that you have in the community. Use simple designs so it can be built by people, by the locals, by the owners, instead of having professionals coming in. And this way you are cutting the cost. And then you can incorporate passive systems for cooling, you can incorporate passive systems for heating and you can include active systems for heating and also for providing the power and so on. What I'm doing is actually basically running calculations for a family of four living in a rural area. How would they actually be able to afford building a system that's very close to a net zero energy system, basically, using off-the-shelf technologies? So we're not talking about something that will be developed 100 years from now or 20 years from now and so on. No, I'm talking about things that you can simply create a shopping list for people in Africa and they simply can go ahead and buy it. Now, I'm guided by the designs of one of my favorite architects, basically. Hassan Fathi, I don't know if you've heard of him. He's an architect from Egypt, and he's considered by many the father of sustainable architecture. He's been calling for sustainable architecture since the 30s and 40s. So long time ago before we had anything related to energy crisis. And he has different books that has different designs. One of them is, one of his most famous books are The Architecture for the Poor, which is very interesting, for adding the word poor to architecture. Just because you're poor, that does not mean that you cannot live in a nice design or nicely designed house. So what he did is he basically designed different structures, and he actually built different structures in Egypt and even here in the US, in New Mexico, using mud brick construction techniques, like what we see here in this village in Egypt. It's called the New Gorna. And actually, the New Gorna is considered by the UNESCO a heritage site that needs to be preserved because of the architecture and sustainable architecture that it has. So I'm guided by these designs here to look at the passive systems that he used for cooling and the passive systems that he used for heating and so on. And this will definitely cut down on the active systems that you can install. Like instead of having to install like three solar panels, you can install just one. So that will definitely cut the cost by simply changing the design. Now, looking at bioenergy, and these are the research that I've done in the past. So instead of looking at burning or consuming bioenergy as is, like the way you get it from the field, instead of doing this, what we're trying to do here is simply process it. So if you have wood logs, break it down to smaller sizes or into wood chips, or form it into pellets and then form it into powders and so on. Why do we bother about doing this? Well, you're increasing the surface area this way. So this means you're allowing more oxygen to go and see the biomass. And this means you can have more efficient combustion than if you were to use a wood log. For instance, if you try to burn a phone book as is, it's not going to burn. It's going to burn only on the edges. It's going to be very hard to burn everything. But if you tear it down and cut it down into pieces and try to burn the same amount, it's going to burn much faster. It's the same concept over here. So you have better diffusion of oxygen. That makes it more efficient and much faster combustion. And if it's much faster combustion, this means you have more power. So if you need heating, but not on a residential scale, but more of an industrial scale, then you can use processed biomass to do this. More efficient, more environmentally friendly way. I'm sorry? Yes, I'm almost done. Yeah. So if you were to look at some of the experiments that we've done, we looked at wood powder flames, we looked at cornstarch flames, we looked at flames from coffee powder and so on. Not that we recommend that you actually do this, but wood powder flame was what we actually were interested in. So we were able to produce a lot of power and a more efficient combustion. And the nice thing about powder combustion, it has the ability of going on and off as you require. If you ever try to grill with charcoal, what do? You set up your charcoal, you have to wait for half an hour till it reaches the proper combustion temperature, right? And then you start grilling and so on. And then when you're done, you have to wait for it to cool down by itself. This is called transient time. And this is the worst time that you can have a biomass in, because this is where you have worst emissions, worst temperatures. Actually, it's not worst temperatures, but worst emissions with respect to the temperature. So you can have a lot of CO coming out because it's inefficient. You can have a lot of long chain hydrocarbons and so on, tar formation and so on. But here in wood powder, this is almost happening instantaneously. So once you switch it on, it goes on, switch it off, it turns off. So that's one of the nice things about wood powder. That's why we were looking at this. Now, when we compared wood powder emissions with pellet emissions from another burner, we were able to see that our wood powder prototype was basically 40% less in PM2.5 emissions. And this is just the very initial prototype, not the modified ones or not the better designed ones. So that's a good improvement over using biomass as a raw material. Gasification, on the other hand, here, what we're trying to do with biomass or bio-waste is actually doing incomplete combustion on purpose. And you do this in sealed reactors. And the reason for that is when you have a bio-waste that's going under incomplete combustion, instead of producing carbon dioxide and water, it produces carbon monoxide, hydrogen, and some traces of CH4. All of these are combustible gases. So you can actually use these gases to run your equipment. So we call it synthetic gas or syngas, or sometimes it's called producer gas. And you can use it for heating if you just were to ignite it directly. I don't recommend that. Or you can create liquid fuels from it, or you can create H2 for fuel cell batteries. However, my favorite use of syngas is actually where to use it directly in engines, to run your car, to run your generator, and so on. So basically the setup looks like this. So you have your gasifier or your reactor, you feed it. So you have a feed system that goes into the gasifier, you're feeding it with biomass in a pellet form or a chip form. It gets gasified, and then you have the syngas going into a gas cleanup system, goes into and then cooling system, and goes in a gas cleanup system, and then it goes into the engine. And this is basically a project that I had back in Sony Cobleskill that I initiated for students. So basically what we did is we bought this small ATV, a John Deere six-wheel drive, and then we bought a commercial downdraft gasifier from Berkeley, from California. And we tried to hook these two up and see how they work. And the idea here is to be able to use waste, farm waste that you find in your farm, right, to run your own farm equipment. So your lawnmowers, your tractors, your ATVs, and so on, without relying on any fossil fuel. So we did this in upstate New York, where they have lots of farming land, that's for sure. Now, if you don't want to use it for your car, you can use it for generating electricity, right? So you can hook it up to a generator, and it does the same thing exactly like your car. This is an example of a 10 kilowatt power gasifier that you can buy directly off the shelf from Berkeley, California. So some of the successful examples, and this is the last slide, by the way. Some of the successful examples are waste to energy. So you can have gasification power plants, and this is what we have in India, for example. So this is good news for people in Egypt, for example, if they want to be using their bio-waste, right? So instead of burning it and then destroying the health of others, they can simply gasify it and get energy out of it. Now, the good news here with regards to Egypt is I found online that there are some people who actually collect the rice husk and the agricultural waste, and they form it into powder and form it into pellets, and they sell it online. I think it's almost $100 per ton, which is good money for that. So if you're talking about job creation, this is a good way of doing green job creation instead of burning it, so you can process it and make use of it. Lighting Africa, it's a program that basically replaces kerosene lamps with LED lights in Africa. The Grameen Shakti in Bangladesh, basically providing green solutions for low-income families. And I believe they use the microloan systems as well, so to provide cost coverage for the green solutions they have. And also there are some nonprofit organizations that are working around the world in terms of teaching people how to use sustainable gardening and teaching people how to build their own solar systems, like for example, solar ovens in Nicaragua here, done by Artists for Sue. Now the last slide, I'm sorry about this, but the last slide is think simple, and this is what I always tell my students. Think simple, don't go like, if you have a problem with energy, don't just say, I'm gonna buy a solar panel or something like that. Look for a simpler solution first and then move to the more complicated solution. Have you ever seen this thing before? You know what this is? It's a... All right, so this is basically a bottle of water, right? Exactly, thank you very much. So now you burned my surprise, you ruined my surprise, but... This is a water bottle light bulb. So basically what they have done is they got a recycled water bottle, filled it up with water and bleach to prevent the formation of mold, and they stuck it on the roof like this. And this is what it do. It's a 55-watt light bulb that runs for 5 years, and all you have to do after 5 years, just open it up, fill it up again, and then close it and seal it again. And it runs perfectly, and it costs like, I think, about 50 cents to produce. And of course, if you go to a recycled waste site or something like that, you can simply collect it for free. Water is for free, I guess, and you can have bleach for a small amount of bleach that's almost close to nothing. So this is a simple idea of how to actually have sustainable energy without having to go the hard way or having a costly way of doing things. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Where is my PowerPoint? Yeah. So till I prepare this, I really wanna extend my thanks to. Thanks. I wanna extend my thanks to Fadl and Matt and all the folks here at the Binzagr Institute for the invitation and also for the warm welcome. I'm from the Haas Institute for a Fair and Inclusive Society at University of California, Berkeley. One thing, I've been working for a couple of years with colleagues of mine on global food system. But since we are in the US, we thought about how about the US food system rather than just the global. So we've been working back and forth between both of the idea of how the global being impacted by the local and vice versa. So I'm very excited to share with you a very comprehensive report we did in the Farm Bill coming out next week. What I'm gonna just run through here is just to give you kind of an overview of that report. I know most of us might know the food system, but the food system, according to the people who study it, is extremely complicated system that include, besides environment, besides the farming territories or people or input or outputs, also encompasses political, economical, social, cultural, and environmental systems. So I'm gonna read just in sake of time. So the United States food system and the outcomes generated by the US Farm Bill are characterized by widespread social, economic, political, and environmental inequity. These outcomes are characteristic of a society that produces inequity in every domain of life, social, economic, political, and environmental lives. Our report finds that inequity within the food system, such as limited access to nutrition and affordable food, high quality land, or farmer support program benefits, cannot be addressed without addressing inequity within society as a whole. Such as low income and limited employment benefits, unfair treatment by the state and federal institutions for the farm workers, and limited democratic influence and access to position of power itself. As such, a central concern for us writing this report was two major things. One is how cooperation actually influencing and controlling our food system, and the second thing is a particular for the US is a structural racialization. And I will go and just define those for you very quickly so I can keep everybody in the same terms as I use them. So for us, the food system is any food system is defined by all processes and infrastructure required to feed a population. Those will be including agricultural productions, harvesting, processing, packaging, distribution, consumption, and disposal as well. As the inputs required, and the outputs produced at each of the stages. What is a structural racialization? Structural racialization is not referred to an individual racism. Let's put that clear. It's referred to a set of practices, cultural norms, and institutional arrangements that are reflective of and help to create and maintain racialized outcomes in society, with racialized outcomes reinforcing group-based advantages and disadvantages. So it's not an act of individuals, it's rather an act of institutions. What is corporate control for in including this talk? By that we mean, I just wanna set up timer for myself, sorry. For that, we mean the control of political and economic systems by corporations in order to influence trade regulation, tax rates, wealth distribution. Just like Saeed shared with us in the beginning, that's exactly what we mean. Today we see that very few controlling too much. That's not good for the health of the planet, it's not good for health of anybody. So among other measures, and to produce favorable environments for further corporate growth. What is the Farm Bill? The Farm Bill, maybe many Americans might know or might not know, but is a multi-year large bill that establishes and maintains federal support for agricultural productions. It seems obvious, but also for nutrition programs, for conservation programs, rural development strategies, and more, and including international aid trade as well, and research and development within the academia. Those programs are operated in large part through the US Department of Agriculture. So this is very quick overview of the current farm bill that passed 2014. The spending over the next 10 years about $1 trillion to cover those programs. So there are 12 programs within this. It's a lot of hell of money. But in terms of structure, the food and agricultural provisions and programs of the Farm Bill are divided into overarching category called titles. I'm here using the word programs. Those titles are not static and can change between farm bills themselves. For example, during reauthorization process in itself, so the 2008 had 15 titles, and the one just passed last year has 12. In terms of the process itself, the Farm Bill comes for renewable roughly every 5 years in Congress. Congressional negotiations on the composition of the bill typically takes between 2 to 3 years. So it's very intensive work for a lot of people. But the particular people, many interest group and corporations shape the Farm Bill by way of lobbying. They do that during the 2 years and 3 years. They're doing that through campaign donation and other such effort. However, we've been seeing that overall, we looked at since 1933 to 2014 farm bills, and we noticed one thing, that there is unbelievable corporate interest and actors that had the greatest influence in pushing for a specific language and policies that advance their respective interests in the farm bill. So that's one surprise for us. And this is one of the reasons why in our methodology we use these two things we thought is very important, how corporate control and influence that bill, but on the other hand, how the racialized outcome of the farm bill impacted communities of color and low-income communities throughout the United States. One of the major program, and many of you probably heard this a lot, is the SNAP, which is previously known as the food stamp. It stands for Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Programs. This program is about 80% of the money of the Farm Bill. Often, especially during the last election, we heard a lot about how especially right-wing think tank and politicians try to stigmatize the folks who live or receive SNAP assistance. But what we don't know, that's almost 50 million Americans use that program. And without that assistance, they will really slip in a dire poverty. And it could be even worse than that. Research shows that for children living in poverty, access to SNAP in childhood, for example, leads to a significant reduction in incidence of obesity, high blood pressure, and diabetes. And for women in particular, single women household head, on the other hand, will increase at least their economic self-sufficiency. Even though we criticize in our report that only having the SNAP within the context of the Farm Bill is not the solution for the poverty, and I will come to that and I will say why. But yet we still see the value of supporting that in the absence of any anti-poverty programs in the United States. So does the cost and benefit ultimately beg the question of whether the SNAP and the Farm Bill more broadly are the best long-term approach to challenging structural poverty, particularly as it's perpetuated by corporate control itself? Despite the challenges and limitation, however, both SNAP and unemployment insurance have indeed have positive effects on both the gross domestic product, the GDP, and on the job growth as well, but also in the long-term effects on the beneficiaries themselves. So now, let me shift gear and talk about it, what we been looking at, what data, and what we found. So when I say racialized outcome that generated the structural racializations in this country, issues like poverty is indeed one of them. But also we find out that also is gendered. So it's not only just hitting people of color, but also women. Low-income folks, people of color, but particularly women. So in 2012, the national average for poverty was about 15%. These numbers are really shocking for a person. I'm from Sudan, by the way. But for a person who thinks that United States is the most powerful economic place, that is still, when I come to study poverty, I looked overseas all the time. It's a problem over there. I was shocked that it's 15% of the population of this country actually live in poverty. Those about like 46.5 million people, a lot of people. Yet poverty rates are strongly associated with race and ethnicity in this country. The poverty rate was 26% for Native Americans, 27.2% for blacks, 25.6% for Latinos, and 11.7% for Asian Americans. On the other hand, for white was about 9.7%. So I don't want to see white people live in poverty, but it bugs the question whether this is structurally racialized. So it's not about intention, but it's about institutions. On the other hand also, all of the family groups live in poverty was the highest among them, the one headed by single women. In 2012, 30.9% of all female-headed families, about 4.8 million families, were in poverty, compared to 6.3 of all married couple families. It's about 3.7 million families. Finally, among children under age of 18, 21.8%, or about roughly 16 million children, live in poverty in 2012. So stratification of the labor market itself reflects an undergrade such trend, with communities of color frequently overrepresented in very lowest paying jobs. For example, in 2012, 26% of blacks and 26% of the Latinos were employed in the service, a notorious low-paying industry known in the United States, while only 17% of whites and 18% of Asian American were employed in such industry. This is another way you could conceptualize and think about the level of food insecurity in this country, because it's again associated with the same manner that we've been looking at poverty. Such since food is part of the GDP, if you will, of families to spend on food. And the average, if you run a calculation, it could be about 14.9% all over the United States. So now let's look at this level of food insecurity in the United States. But before I do that, I just would like to read for you the World Health Organization when they define food security. Food security as having consistent access to sufficient, safe, nutritious food to maintain a healthy and active life. That's it. But for us, we think at the heart of it is actually is a matter of income and poverty. So there is plenty of food in the United States, but some of us cannot access it. Not us in the room, but us in the United States. With that in mind, all programs that aim to remedy food insecurity, most notably the Farm Bill SNAP, hold potential not only as a key nutrition assistance programs, but are also part of the anti-poverty programs and safety net to support historically marginalized communities in the United States, including low-income communities and communities of color. This is especially the case was we seen during economic hardship. But here again, we talk about food insecurity in terms of how it's racialized and how it's gendered. It's very shocking, the level percentage of people who live as food insecure. In 2013, 14%, or about 17.5 million of households, excuse me, those roughly about 50 million people, were food insecure at least sometimes during the year, with 5.6% of the household experiencing very low food security. As with poverty, food insecurity is strongly associated again with race and ethnicity, and you can just look at the numbers. I have to move quickly. This is another forces that we see in within the corporate control and influence in our food system. So this is the second force for us. It's not only control, but also exacerbated food security is the corporate control in the food system. Corporate power has long played a role in the institutions, processes, practices, and infrastructure that make up almost all of the US food system, how food is produced, how food is processed, distributed, and consumed. So despite the fact that 95.3% of US farms are small and mid-sized family-owned operations, the remaining 4.7% of US farm, which include large-scale family-owned and non-family-owned operation, accounted for almost 50% of the total value of production. I checked the number 100 times, because I couldn't believe it. As of 2007, four corporations owned 85% of the soybean processing industry, 82% of the beef packing industry, 63% of the pork packing industry, and manufacture about half of the milk we have. While five corporations control 53% of the grocery retail, more than what I have here on the slide. And globally, believe it or not, only about 500 companies control 70% of the food choices. Among them, the Big Ten, that they generate every year $450 billion. Those include companies you might know of, associated British Food, Coca-Cola, Danone, General Mills, Kellogg, Mars, Mondelez International, Nestle, PepsiCola, and Unilever. Furthermore, 12 companies, and I will talk about this later on, also now accounted for about almost 53% of the ethanol production and the production capacity, and they own 38% of all ethanol production plant. So even if when we think about alternative gap creation, we have to think of the role of corporate in controlling that sector. But within those corporations, we looked at the idea of how is racialized, how is gender. And you can see for yourself is really staggering. So as of 2012, for example, the large majority of corporate director of Fortune 500 companies were white men, at average of 74.4%, and alibi substantially lower white women at 13.3%, although white men and women make up 72.4% of the US population. And despite making up 12.6% of the US population, only 3% of the corporate directors were Latinos. Within that, 2.4 are men and 0.7 are women. Finally, despite making 13.6% of the US population, only 6.8% of the corporate directors were black. 5.3% of them are men, 1.5% are black women. So it's very staggering, but it gets even worse. I'm sorry to be the bearer of the bad news. But here again, we looked at the, I don't know if you can see it clearly, we looked at the farmland in the United States and its value also. We noticed very similar. We didn't have data about gender, but we're very sure it's extremely racialized. As of 1999, all private US agricultural land, white people accounted for 96% of the owner. That's about 3.2 million people. And also they accounted for 97% of all of agricultural value. It's about $1.16 trillion. And 98% of the acres of that land. On the other hand, blacks, Native American, Asian Americans, and Latinos and Latinas together accounted for only 4% of the honor. There are about 146,000 people, 146,703 people. 3% of all of agricultural value, that what they have, about $44 billion. And 2.8% of the acres is about 25 million acres of agricultural land. I'm making a case here, it's obvious, right? So I have to give all this data in order to say what I wanted to say. But not only that. Also, in a venue like this, thinking about how we can take care of the planet and people and to be prosper, the environment is really play a key role in the food system. We know that conventional agricultural production practices are, which are encouraged by major food and agricultural policy, including, in particular, and believe it or not, the US Farm Bill, are a major contributor to global climate change. According to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and US Environmental Protection Agency, the agricultural sector is the largest contributor to global anthropogenic non-CO2 green gas emissions, accounting for 56% of the emission in 2005. So having food is not an easy thing. In 2013, the EPA reported that the greenhouse gas emission from agriculture accounted for about 9% of the total US greenhouse gas emission, an increase of about 17% in 1990. So industrial or conventional agricultural practice, in particular characterized by the use of many things we know of, such as high yielding plant, animal variety, large scale monocrops, and it goes on, is also a high level of synthetic fertilizers and pesticides. And the list is going on. All of them together have really large impact on our climate. Furthermore, these practices are themselves made possible through the corresponding use of fossil fuel to power the production of agrochemicals, agromachinery, and increased level of irrigations. In the backdrop of increasing competition for biofuels, as a noble thing people might think about it, production, large tracts of agricultural land now have been used for biomass production instead of food. As a result, we have seen increased food prices and price fertility for many crops that hurt both side of equation. The small farmer get hurt when we have experienced shifting in prices, but also consumer at the other hand. So in, for example, between 20% and 40% of the global food prices increase in 2008 were caused by biofuel expansion. Several studies projected that by 2017, biofuel production could really increase prices for many of the world's staple food. This is, it seems like overwhelming problems, but we think that there is really solutions. So, but we need to think. So in our thinking, we have two ways we think about that, short-term and long-term strategies. One, to do policy intervention as the political reality allow us to do, and others, maybe we have to create a different reality. So I'm not gonna go to my list. Believe me, it's long. But all what you see in the screen is a noble and important things to do, but it's not enough. So in terms of agricultural production policies, we need to pressure and support the following. Restore the minimum price of crops. Reduce high food prices by eliminate biofuel crops payments. All this within the farm bill, by the way. So that's my 20 minutes right there. So I have another 10, great. I'm happy. yeah, thank you. So we need to increase the Department of Labor funding to enforce protection for migrant and seasonal agricultural workers. We need to improve access to financing for land and water for new farmers, especially young farmers, low-income farmers, and farmers of color. In terms of the farmers' outreach and assistance, we need to improve outreach and assistance to farmers of color, continue and expand cash advance for environmental quality incentive programs. I know you don't maybe know the context of what I'm just saying. It sounds like this is kind of strange. But all this is program supported by the Farm Bill. That's $956 billion. So, but it's done in a way that is not doing this. It's doing something else. So we need to take it back to make it do what it needs to be doing. In terms of research and development for best practices in agriculture, we believe that we need to redirect federal research agenda to support public interest initiative and not corporations. Increase funding for renewable energy research and not biofuel productions or projects. In terms of public assistance programs like the SNAP and other nutrition programs, we need to monitor and reduce corporate influence and gain from SNAPs because they make a hell of money out of it. In terms of long-term strategy, sorry for my ugly drawing, but we believe that you cannot have all these demands unless you have a very powerful social movement that is united, that is, like Saeed irritated in the beginning, that the people at the top or the people in the middle, they work as a buffer zone. So if we don't have the power to mobilize the people in the middle, we cannot see change. So when I say united, why we choose food? I'm not an agriculturalist, by the way. But I found that in food system and food movement, you could really generate a great positive social change because it could unite all these groups, all of them together and more. You can get all ecological defense folks, racial justice people. You have to think about immigration and refugees. You have to think anti-militarism. You have to think about communities of faith. You have to think about gay and lesbian and bisexual and transgender. You have to think about what we do to our nature, how we build communities, how we abolish the prison system, how we think about economic justice, how we give indigenous people their sovereignty back, how we can support our sister, the feminist and gender justice. So in order to do this, we propose three actions could be taken, or four. One, remove SNAP completely from the Farm Bill. I know people get mad at me when I say that. They really get mad. But in order to be beyond the corporate control, we have to do that. But to do that, not just to throw it out and to throw these people under the bus, no. Then we have to redesign SNAP as an anti-poverty program. Not only nutrition, but to say people live in poverty, we need to help them. We have the moral obligation to help them. It's not just we can't give a handout to 47%. No, yes, we do. We do, and we have to do it. And the second thing in terms of the rural development program, we need to strengthen. There is, in the Farm Bill, there is really very successful models. So not all of it is bad. So there is a very successful model in terms of rural development programs. We need to strengthen those, and any other programs look like that. And also we need to create, because that it does two things. It create and boost up employment opportunity for communities in rural areas. But we need to pressure USDA and Congress and all the lobby around it in Washington, D.C. belt to give those programs more central role in uplift farmers and the communities in which they live and work. Finally, to do all this, we really need to bring cooperation into their alignments. We are not anti-corporations. What we see that there is intrusion of corporate in the public space. They have to go back and do what they do and what they've been designed to do. So through legal means or political means, we need to put back cooperation in their square. We don't say don't work or don't do and don't produce, no. You have specific things to do, just do them and stay out of the way of politics, out of the way of essential program like anti-poverty programs. So finally, I will say this. We believe that structural change requires powerful and united food movement in order to make demands. And we also believe that such movement have to be a diverse and to be for racial equity, because a just and democratic food system is not simply the end goal for such a movement. Rather, it's also a strategic means to challenging the structure that embed the possibility for a just life for all peoples in all domains of life. Only when the tactical agenda that I mentioned earlier, the short-term ones, and work of the broad-based food justice movement uphold a wealth, race, ethnicity, and gender-based moral meta-narrative, then can the struggle for low-income communities and communities of color and women face with regard to the food system be connected to the struggle that they face elsewhere, including in labor movement, unemployment, health, housing, the school-to-prison pipeline, and police violence, among other things. Only then can such a movement truly strive for a just life that upholds dignity for all peoples, not for the few. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And our third paper, Aqdas, Afzal from University of Missouri, Kansas City, Energy, Economy, and Ecology, Reimagining the Troika.
Okay. Guys, can you hear me okay? Thank you for your presentation. Well, as you know, I have to set up my PowerPoint that I forgot. Okay. It's here somewhere. Okay. This one. Oh, was it? Sorry. Completely. All right. As you know, my name is Aqdas Afzal. I am associated with the Binzagr Institute as well as the University of Missouri, Kansas City, and I'm very happy to be here. This is actually my second trip to Denison. I first visited about 15 years ago. You know, I was on the Ohio State team. I went to Ohio State here in Columbus playing squash. So Denison used to have a really good squash team. I don't know if it's still good or no. So glad to be back. Okay, so the topic of my presentation is energy, ecology, and economy, reimagining the Troika. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about these three different ideas and their intersections. Okay, so I just wanted to bring people up to speed. Some people here are very familiar with what is going on with respect to climate, but some of the recent developments I just wanted to bring to your attention. So as you know that China's President Xi was here recently, and among the news it was told that China is developing its own cap and trade system. So they're going to cap the number of emissions and then trade them. They're developing their own system. So one of the things that really caught my eye as I was reading about this in the newspaper was that the motivation behind China developing this cap and trade system was really the danger that these, do you remember, Ahmed showed that picture from Beijing. You know, they had to show the sunrise and sunset on some big screen. So one of the reasons why they're putting this together is that these dangerous levels of pollution may end up causing some political instability. So that's one of the motivations. I mean, that's the extent or magnitude of pollution in China at the moment. Most people here, Pope Francis was also in the United States recently. He's come out with this official letter, which is called an encyclical. And in this letter, the Pope is now talking about, you know, caring for the environment. So I just wanted to, everybody knows that, but some people probably didn't read about that. Okay, and finally, I think most importantly is this United Nations Climate Change Conference which is also known as COP21 or CMP11, that's going to take place in late November and early December in Paris. It's a very important conference because the objective is to bring together all these different nations and to have legally binding agreements on climate change. So I thought that was interesting. And just wanted to bring people up to speed. Okay, this is helpful. Okay, so 20 years, let's fast forward 20 years. You know, let's look at 2035. So the previous slide was 2015, this is 2035. And none of this, I mean, I'm not making it. This is from an actual report that was published by one of the leading oil companies. So this is their data. Let's look at what they're saying. So they're saying that global economic output is expected to increase by about 115% in the next 20 years. And a big part of that, about 60%, is going to come from China and India. Carbon dioxide is expected to grow by 25%. There is a scenario, it's called 450 scenario by the International Energy Agency, IEA, which basically seeks to limit the concentration of carbon dioxide to 450 parts per million. Even though carbon dioxide is going to grow by 25% as opposed to 115% economic growth, it's still too high. And finally, this really caught my eye and I thought it was interesting. In about 20 years, China and India are going to become net importers of oil. So China is going to be importing about 13 million barrels per day, and India is going to be importing about 7 million barrels per day. And just to give you a comparative, the US was importing about 12 million. So the US about around 14 million barrels per day right now, around that number. Can I, sure, go ahead.
Sorry, you just said it came from an oil company?
Yes. I mean, BP, that's an oil company. Okay, yeah, so they just came out with a major report. So this is this information is from BP's oil report, or report. Okay, so the point that I was trying to make is that, I mean, consider this: this massive dependency of China and India on oil, and what does that mean for international geopolitics? I mean, China is already moving closer and closer to Middle Eastern sources of energy by developing this string of different little ports that they call string of pearls. So, I mean, we just need to think about these things as well. Okay, so going forward a little bit more, 2050, different impact scenarios. So, I mean, the optimistic scenario is that somehow we are able to prevent global warming, and the total amount of global warming is going to be less than 2 degrees Celsius. However, according to a report by the United Nations, the World Bank, the title of which is Turn Down the Heat, they're saying that about 1.5 degrees Celsius increase is already locked into the Earth's atmospheric system. So even if everything works according to plan, we're still looking at increasing global warming by 2 degrees Celsius as of right now. Realistic scenario is we are kind of in that region, 2 degrees Celsius around 2050, and that is going to bring about a number of very interesting scenarios, including declining crop yields, changing water resources, moving disease ranges. So the different tropical diseases, dengue fever, has anybody ever heard of dengue fever? Happens in Brazil. I'm from Pakistan, and Pakistan has been fighting against dengue fever for years now. So I recently read in the news that there is a massive epidemic in New Delhi of dengue fever. Now, so these disease ranges are changing in the world. There's Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome. I mean, the disease range of that could change. Ebola is an epidemic. So, I mean, we're looking at a scenario where some of these disease ranges could get out of control. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just trying to see different impact scenarios. A pessimistic scenario, that global warming kind of breaches that 2 degrees Celsius threshold. So we are in the neighborhood, say we are in the neighborhood of 4 degrees Celsius. Two authors, Wagner and Weitzman, have come out with a new book, which was reviewed in the New York Review of Books. And they're saying that it seems like if we reach that level, 4 degrees Celsius, we are going to get into what they are calling the new climate normal. And there's a new normal, but then they're calling it the new climate normal. And what does that mean? So what they're saying is that, you know, everybody here is familiar with tail events. So there is a, so events that in the tails of a of a normal distribution are unlikely, you know, that the probability is, there's a low probability of that. So what they're saying is that if we get into that range, the probability of these tail events, catastrophic tail events, is going to rise. And we don't know what that is going to bring about. One of the things that could, however, happen is because of massive climate change, we could see, you know, mass displacement of human populations. I mean, if water resources dry up, I mean, there are over 1 billion people who live in India. If something happens to change the rural way of life, if agriculture dries up, I mean, where are those people going to go? So if we think, if we've seen a lot of migrants, refugees, and those kind of problems, imagine a scenario in which all these people are looking for a place to go. Okay, so which brings me to some of the work that I am doing at UMKC. And I just want to talk about three different strands of literature that try to assess the relationship between economic growth and energy consumption. So the first one is environmental economics. Now I'm gonna speak a little bit about economic history, and then finally ecological economics. Okay, so environmental economics. Well, some people here know that our average, or you know, your usual neoclassical growth models, economic growth models, like Solow, for example, when they talk about output, they don't really incorporate energy into the picture. So you basically have, I mean, that little thing up there, Y equals A times F, K and L, that's capital and labor. I mean, there's no energy in the picture. And what's the reason why there is no energy in the picture? I mean, the reason is that a lot of economists believe that because of constant technological innovation, we are always going to be able to substitute non-renewable resources with capital. So we're always going to have, I mean, this is their belief, we're always going to have this ability to be able to substitute non-renewable resources with capital. What that means is, what they're trying to say is, that there is no meaningful physical limit, and that our to our capacity to keep growing forever. This is the interpretation. And so capital and energy are considered substitutes in environmental economics, because there is this great belief in constant technological innovation. It's also sometimes referred to as technological optimism, you know, being too much, being too optimistic about technology. Yeah, so I mean, I'm just going to skip that because I just spoke about that right now. Okay, so one of the leading ideas within environmental economics is this idea called environmental Kuznets curve. I'm just going to show you a picture. So this is what the environmental Kuznets curve kind of looks like. So the idea is that, so there is per capita income on the horizontal axis and environmental deterioration on the vertical axis. So the idea is that as countries start becoming richer or, you know, making more income, initially there is degradation in terms of the environment. There is more pollution, and then there comes a point, some kind of turning point, where things start to get better. So the idea is what they're trying to say is that there is a potential decoupling going on that can happen between energy consumption and environmental pollution. And I'm just explaining here that it's the relationship, the environmental Kuznets curve is the relationship between pollution intensity and GDP. So this is one of the main ideas within environmental economics. Okay, so one of the ideas in environmental economics is that somehow there can be a decoupling between GDP. GDP can keep growing, however, our energy use will start decreasing. And we'd be able to do that because we have this ability to have constant technological innovation because we can substitute between capital and energy. But, you know, if you look at economic history, there are people who've been talking about it. That idea has been challenged, that somehow we can keep growing without using, you know, energy. So, for example, research from Wrigley, I mean, he compares Britain and the Netherlands. Before I get there, let me explain that in economic history, the Industrial Revolution is taken as a proxy for economic growth. So Industrial Revolution, maybe 1750 onwards, roughly, or maybe before that. So some of these people are arguing that have shown that despite similar institutions, you know, the Dutch economic growth in the Netherlands came up against an energy resource constraint. Britain, which had its own domestic coal mines, was able to keep growing, and thus it was not able to come up against an energy constraint. So this is an idea which is which directly opposes the main finding of the environmental economics in the sense that these guys are arguing that there is no substitution between energy and capital. So it's not possible to keep growing forever. And then I have some more evidence here. For example, work by Coward, 1994, shows that as the price of wood started increasing in Europe, Britain was able to keep growing economically compared to the rest of the countries like the Netherlands and Belgium. Okay, so finally, ecological economics. They take issue with the idea of substitution between capital and energy. And, you know, ecological economists argue that there are, in fact, limits to nature. You cannot keep growing forever. So remember, the first one was environmental economics. They believe there are no limits to nature. There's substitution between capital and energy. This is ecological economics. These guys believe that there are limits to nature. We cannot keep growing forever. And the reason is that you cannot really substitute between capital and energy. And they take issue with the idea of, you know, this technology optimism that somehow we will always possess this ability to keep growing forever, keep innovating technologically and thus keep growing forever. I mean, one of the ideas that I came across was interesting. It says that technological innovation actually leads to more, not less use of energy. That's an interesting idea. So the mechanism that is played out is, you know, so you get a new technology, say, you know, a new way of, making solar energy or whatever, oil. These new ways of making a fuel, the argument goes, decreases the price. And this decrease in price leads to more usage of that quantity. And this idea is also known as Jevons paradox. Okay, so just some background information. Within the ecological economics, their theory of energy is based on the second law of thermodynamics. So they argue that no production process, no matter how efficient that production process is, can recover all the energy it uses up. So there's a lower limit, meaning, all production processes are going to use up a certain amount of high-grade energy and use high-grade energy to turn that into low-grade energy, meaning that the total amount of disorder or entropy in the system will keep increasing. Some ecological economists have made the case that the rising standards of living, so what this means is that no matter how efficient our production processes, we are still going to be using or wasting some amount of energy. So if we keep making more and more and more stuff, say especially in the developed world, this means that we are going to keep using more and more and more energy. Okay, so finally, there is also a strand which is known as energy GDP. I'm calling it energy GDP nexus. I mean, these are just using econometrics to test causation between economic growth and energy consumption. I mean, a lot of people here, so what I'm trying to say is, what these guys are trying to test is, does economic growth cause energy consumption, or does energy consumption drive economic growth? And a lot of people think that the relationship is clear cut. But when it comes to this strand of literature, you'd be surprised, there is no consensus. I mean, I have looked at studies for India, for example. I mean, a study says that it's economic growth that drives energy consumption. 2 years after that, you have a study that says, no, it's energy consumption that drives economic growth. There are some studies which find bidirectional causality. Well, economic growth causes energy consumption, but then energy consumption causes economic growth. So there is confusion. We don't really know what causes which. But there is an interesting point hidden in this strand of literature. So by entertaining the possibility that somehow it is economic growth that causes energy consumption, we are also entertaining the possibility that somehow, if we can find an alternate way of growing economically, you know, so economic growth is causing energy consumption, we don't really need that energy consumption for economic growth, so we can actually move towards a renewables-based energy regime. We don't have to keep relying on a fossil fuel-based energy regime. So there is the possibility that economic growth can actually go on without energy consumption. Okay, I'm just going to skip the last point. And I just talked about not having any consensus in the field. And I just want to note that given the laws of thermodynamics, the stuff that I talked about, that ecological economists believe that no matter which production process we are using and how efficient that production process might be, it is always going to use waste some amount of energy. It seems a little surprising that that somehow we can end up with a decoupling between energy consumption and economic growth. Oh, finally, this may be interesting for some people here. So this is a relationship that I'm looking at in my research. You know, how fossil fuels or energy import leads to monetary policy stagnation, especially in non-oil importing emerging economies. So this is the mechanism that I am looking at. So I'm talking about policy implications of continued reliance on a high energy import bill. So what I'm looking at right now is that higher energy import bills, you know, once an emerging economy has to import energy in the shape of oil or natural gas or what have you, causes capital outflows. So normally, it would be possible for the exchange rate to, normally there would be a way to correct that balance of payments by having, this is my second last slide, so I'm almost done, by through a correction in exchange rate. However, in order to maintain a stable exchange rate, and as certain economists have pointed out, Jan Kregel, for example, in some papers, countries need to keep a stable exchange rate because the stable exchange rate serves as an anchor to inflation expectations. And most of the investors outside of that country require a stable exchange rate in order to invest in a particular emerging economies. So you have a stable exchange rate, and at the same time, you have to maintain a tight monetary policy because you want to offer that high interest rate differential to investors outside. So your monetary policy basically becomes a prisoner to all these capital flows, inflows that you have to attract from the outside. So Keynes pointed this out in his treatise on money, chapter 36, that and certain other economists have developed on this idea that international financial liberalization, meaning free outflow and inflow of capital, especially since the collapse of Bretton Woods, has led to to developing nations taking on a Ponzi profile. And I'm kind of in the process of building this idea as we speak. So that is my presentation. Thank you very much.
So we need everyone because of the filming. We need everyone who is asking a question questions for all three, but I was, you know, I didn't want to. Ahmed, the one thing, just a small manner, when you talk about, I think you called it biomass, you know, human and animal waste, I was just wondering whether, you know, the calculations that you had there factored in for any use of that as fertilizer, because I know in those countries where there's been deforestation that the use of animal dung, you know, dried animal dung for energy has led to a decline in productivity in farming. For Aqdas, I think that Simon you were quoting up there, if that's Julian Simon, the ultimate resource, you know, the thing, I mean, you were emphasizing, I guess, constant technological innovation, but it really, the argument would require, you know, more than that, because it's not just that eventually, I mean, this school argues that economic growth always provides the answer to any problem economic growth creates. That's what they believe in. His book was called Knowledge, the Ultimate Resource, or, you know, which, who's gonna, you know, take the position against that, right? So, but are those innovations always emerging in a timely manner relative to the problem? Yeah, maybe eventually we'll, you know, discover answers, but the real technological optimism requires that the, and of course, if you push this, then they go back to the magic of the price mechanism, and some of you may recall, there was a famous bet between Julian Simon and Paul Ehrlich, the biologist, around 1970, about what would happen to a variety of resource prices over the next 10 years. And famously, Simon won the bet and Ehrlich lost the bet. The mistake that both made was betting on what was going to happen to prices, because they both are assuming that prices actually reflect resource scarcity. Even in orthodox economics, that only is true under the most severe conditions. I mean, in terms of the assumptions that you have to make for prices to actually reflect resource scarcity. So even Frank Hahn, one of the developers of neoclassical theory, said that, you know, whenever someone says that all that we have to wait for is prices to rise if a resource gets scarce or whatever, then you should explain to them that assumes, you know, perfect knowledge on the part of all participants, perfect knowledge of the future, perfect futures markets, complete, you know, markets, and no money in the economy, and on and on and on with the, you know, the assumptions that would be required for that actually to hold. I just thought I would mention that. And Elsadig, it's going to bother me if I don't remember. But you know, if nobody has anything to say, I'd be very disappointed. I'd be very disappointed if nobody has anything to say. But okay.
Okay, I was, okay, so the one curve where the human development index, and you said like 50 energy servants it levels off. And then you're talking about can you have growth without now you'll have so with efficiency, I mean, one of the things that's we're like the Western, we're so inefficient that if we focus a lot on inefficiency, like California has had, you know, they had a lot of growth and really not much energy change. But I presumably at some point then you'd get where if you really were efficient, then things would change. I mean, then you'd have to have. But we right now we're so inefficient that, what do you think?
So basically, these two has to be coupled. You cannot really talk about renewable energy systems without talking about conserving energy in the first place. As for the question that Matt was asking about biomass and the use of biomass and how would that affect agriculture, for example, actually, if you notice that I was not, even though I used that term biomass, but I was actually referring to always to bio-waste. And the reason for that is because there's always the debate or the issue of fuel versus food issue, right? So I'm more of favor, more in favor of bio-waste. Whatever you're going to be throwing away anyway, whatever is left over, let's make use of it, right? Now, in terms of fertilization, of course, using animal dung is always has been the traditional way of fertilizing things. In the case of biomass and bio-waste energy, some people call it as, or consider it as carbon neutral, meaning whatever gets emitted in the atmosphere in terms of carbon can get reabsorbed again by the plant, and then we start using it again. However, some people consider gasification, the gasification process, as carbon negative. And the reason for that is the leftover char can actually be used as a fertilizer. And I'm not sure if the word carbon negative is actually good, but or represents accurately what's going on, but in terms of the process itself, it's good. So you're producing energy from waste, that's number one. Number two, you're actually using whatever's left over to fertilize the land and produce better biomass.
Thank you. Go ahead.
sorry, Mr. Elsheikh. I was very interested in your comments about the corporate control and corporate impact on the agriculture. And you mentioned specifically we need to bring corporations into alignment. I'm wondering if you're familiar with the concept here in the United States that corporations are considered persons with constitutional rights. Is that something that you have considered in working towards alignment? And I say that because that's what I'm involved with. Is that something that is meaningful to you? And
what we've seen in the last over 100 years, that cooperation, even the founding father of this nation thought about cooperation have very specific role to play in American society. Today, we cannot ignore that the role in which that cooperation actually they undermine not only equality, but they undermine even the democratic system of United States. And that's need no evidence. But one of the things that I think the activist justice in the Supreme Court, in the right, not the one in the left, especially during the Citizen United, they really turn over a long-standing tradition in American politics for 100 years that consider cooperation as a person. That was, in my opinion, my humble opinion, and the institute I work for is extreme deviation from having a democratic society that's individual who live in the society have say actually in their design of their cultural, social, political institutions. So if we don't have any say to say in our institutions, I'm not sure if that's this type of democracy is have any useful for us. So what we're suggesting are the following. We file a lot of amicus briefs in the Supreme Court to actually turn down Citizen United. We've been unsuccessful, but we will continue to do so. We think that corporations have a role in society, whether that's a public corporations or private corporation. We have fantastic public corporation. One of them is the BPS, right? One of them, it could be here in Ohio, could be EBA, the American Electric Power, right? So always, cooperation is not a bad thing, but how you design them and their role, and to control their role, like just you control citizens, is very important. You cannot let them not only design politics, but actually driving politics in the United States. So what we see now, most of our public officials, they cannot go against cooperation. The reason is simple. And maybe Rohan, maybe tomorrow they will talk about it, the modern money network. If we don't get money out of politics, we don't.
But it's not just money. That's the point I want to make. You mentioned Citizens United. Citizens United is all about money. Corporate personhood is the courts and the right of a corporation to get what it wants by taking a case to court and winning because they have the money to support their case.
No,
that's a completely different thing from Citizens United.
I'm not quite sure if I think that consider corporate as a personhood, first of all, is the right thing to do in a mature democracy.
No, but it is. It is a fact.
Please,
that's my point.
Could you just, take your seat again and
okay.
We'll continue with the, we're only going to go into a back and forth so much on a tangential topic or whatever, especially if you represent that.
Can I just close my?
Yeah, sure.
So the idea is that we could have a different legal argument about that. But what I'm trying to say throughout history, in particular in the United States, that corporation always had a very specific role to play. Corporation are not person. Corporation cannot be considered a person. That's a twist of the American Constitution since we have Citizen United. Corporation cannot think. Corporation doesn't have a religious. The corporation doesn't have, so if we agree on all this, the current reality, the current political reality in the United States tell us otherwise. So we need to turn that around. Corporation could play an effective, good role, but one of the power of corporation also, besides the legal means, is money. And that's when they've been able to co-opt the system and to create a foot soldier within our Congress, actually to lobby for them rather than the other way around. So I will stop here.
Yes, go ahead, Paul.
Sure. Hi, Paul Herman, HIP investor. I'm speaking tomorrow, so if I ask a tough question, please bring one tomorrow. My question really focuses on, thanks for your presentations, which were all fascinating. My question really focuses about this energy and GDP. So obviously the X factor is, what is the innovation and what are the limits? So California has been able to grow GDP while not growing emissions as fast, so that's great. But these world outlooks, especially like BP's, finally we got the Exxon report from the 1970s that said there's this big upswing in emissions that's coming that got repressed but finally open sourced recently. So my question is really around, what are the structures that you think will work? Carbon tax, cap and trade, some other type of, what mix of policy, capitalism, and other structures can come together, whether they be transparency, like the SEC can mandate but hasn't yet, the Sustainability Accounting Standards Board and Carbon Disclosure Project, combined with whatever tax policy or incentive structure to get that GDP to emissions to go in an innovative way. Thanks.
Thank you for your question. I think that's a brilliant question, because you have just cut to the chase and asked me, what needs to be done. Well, I looking at some interesting literature, which is known as the energy regime literature. And that talks about how the world went from having coal as the dominant fossil fuel to having petroleum or oil, shall we say, you know, petroleum and diesel as the dominant fuel. And it's a world systems approach or the long wave approach in the literature. And they really link it to first the domination of the British Empire, and the fuel for the British Empire was really coal. And as the British Empire started declining, you see this ascent of oil as the dominant fuel. So the story being painted is that a fuel is not used for energy generation just because it has certain properties. It is also used because there are certain types of institutional frameworks that enable the greater usage of that fuel. So there is this approach in the literature which is known as the energy systems approach. I think you mentioned energy systems, but I don't know if you were referring to it in the way that I'm about to refer to it right now. Okay, so this energy systems approach, which says that the usage of energy in any system cannot be dissociated from the institutional or the political framework. So in the final analysis, obviously, we are going to have to move towards an entire new institutional framework or a new energy regime, if you will, in which you would have the requisite policies, incentives, and institutions to move modern production processes from being reliant on fossil fuels today to being reliant on renewable fuels in the future. So what we really require is a sea change in a number of different things, not only incentives, but institutional framework as well.
Thank you. Yes?
Can I add one thing?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So I think this is really very difficult question. In my opinion, I don't think that carbon tax, carbon credit, all the above are going to work, because it's still, I come from a background of a structural arrangement of anything you do, anything you design. So structurally will harm all the poor and the marginalized, whether that in global context or within the global north itself. So if you can imagine, since 1960, I wasn't born yet, but we consume almost 40% of the ecosystem of the earth. So there is no way we can go this way, no matter what we do. So I think there is a profound problem in the political economic system we have today, which is a neoliberalism that extremely privatized every aspect of our life. So we need other people of this planet, that we care about planet nature and the smaller human species. We need to figure out a system that is more fair and equitable, and we can share it for good. So the idea that I can go and, because I have the ability to dump my carbon toxic in other nations because I can pay money, that's really one of the most criminal acts I could think of if anyone come from out of the environment telling me that. But what I think, like a country like, for example, Norway, using their sovereign wealth and completely de-invest from fossil fuel, even though their economy is fossil fuel economy, that's for me a hopeful way. So we can think more innovative how we can use our money, even our sovereign wealth as country. Qatar, for example, have the same amount of money and the same innovative idea of Norway, but they didn't use their money to create, to divest from fossil fuel. We need to push those in a larger scale of things, in a larger scheme of things, a structural way that we're going to inhabit this climate. I work within climate refugees. So what Aqdas proposed, it's not a gloom scenario. It's happening, but the scale of it is small. We are not noticing. Over time, it's going to happen unless we intervene today, not tomorrow, right now.
Yes, sir.
My question frames it around the global economy versus localizing the economy. what Ahmed proposed in terms of the simplicity approach to easiest, simplest solution would be consistent with a localized solution. Elsadig's comments about the food system, localization of the food system would be seemingly an antidote to what the commodity, larger global food system that we have. I'm not so sure about the other presentation. It certainly relates to whether the energy knowledge issues, if you look at it in terms of the global economy, that's one way to look at it. But people like David Corton, Michael Schumann, Stacy Mitchell, people looking at it from the point of view of the localization as an antidote. There's a film produced by the International Society for an Ecological Culture out of Berkeley that called Economics of Happiness, which would argue that localization is really the antidote to the excesses of the global economy, which are creating the global warming climate change issues.
I did remember my point, I mean my question about Elsadig's paper, and that was on those poverty numbers, was that as defined by the official US poverty line? Because as you know, as we all know, I mean,
yes.
That is, you know, I always tell okay. kids, anybody who sets that should have to live on it for a year, live on whatever the line is. So that, if you used maybe, you know, an alternative measure, it would the numbers would be even, you know.
No, you are absolutely right. One of the challenges when you work with data is you have to rely on some centralized data, right? So we know that the whole unemployment rate and poverty rate are all is bogus numbers in the United States,
right.
And the number in reality is really higher than that. But even giving those the lower ones
right.
is really shocking details. But if I may just go back to this idea of localized, globalize. I think the solution has to come from both. So I'm a big proponent of a huge movement in the global south called food sovereignty. It's going beyond just localize it. Yes, local food system is extremely important because we could take some actors out of this equation. One of them is the fossil fuel consumptions. We know today that if we just check the food we ate today, it will most likely come from far away. And this idea of making those items so cheap and available to us is really not harming only the people who are harvesting them or working or breaking their back, but actually harming our environment, right? So that's everyday struggle we have to grapple with. So the food sovereignty movement emerged and led by the largest social movement of peasant farmers in the world, La Via Campesina, the base of the peasant. Emerged from Latin America, but today it existed everywhere, including North America. It consists of six principles, basic, that food is not for trade, period. Food is for people. People have the right to design their own food system, how their agricultural design, who consumes them, how they do that, and their food has to be culturally appropriate to them. So we don't feed the people who don't like rice because that's what is available. The second thing that food and the producer of food has to be respected, in particular women, because today we know that 70% of our food in the global south coming from women, 70% of our food, and we have no whatsoever economic respect for them, and actually we have physical violence against them, so that needs to be changed, and that's led by a global system, not by a local system. That's not a corrupt politician somewhere in this place or that place, but this is a centralized themes of neoliberalization of every aspect of our human life. So we need to think of this. If we think about food sovereignty, we could think about those intersection of local and global, because local is global and global is local. I agree with you completely.
Thank you very much, and I just want to ask if you want the other two want a final word, or you? Okay, all right. Last question.
Okay, I'm Ellen Brown, and I'll be speaking tomorrow. This conference is about sustainable full employment. So in the 70s, we had stagflation, and it was argued that you couldn't have full employment without driving up prices. And then the response to that that we money reformers always make is, yes, you can, because if you put people to work, they will have more money to spend. They will spend it on goods and services, and the market will respond by producing more goods and services, so goods and services will rise to meet demand. So I always make that argument, and there's always one young person, you know, because they worry about these things, that will say, yes, but if you increase supply, then you will use up the natural resources. So I just wondered how you all would respond to that. I mean, I have a response that I do, but since you're kind of experts in that field, maybe you've got some.
Well, I will just say that the entire rest of the conference, I think,
will answer that.
Well, not will answer, I don't want to say that, but addresses.
Right.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
We have to produce enough to live without destroying the earth and ourselves, right? I mean, our economic requirements set certain kinds of minimal requirements, right? In terms of we have to have enough food for everybody who's alive, and right? And then, you know, not destroying the earth and ourselves kind of sets a maximum. I mean, there's qualitative, for sure, aspects as well. But either problem alone would be challenging enough. But both at once is the challenge of our time. Of course, all of these other issues, you know, that people are raising are also part of the big picture. But of course, if the panel would like their, you know, want to address the answer the question. It's a very hard question to answer in a short period of time. But yeah, I mean, we will all be discussing this for the next, you know, 30 hours. Okay, let's thank our presenters. And please join us for a reception, coffee, tea.
Dinner upstairs.
And dinner upstairs.